Chief.
Good evening.
A very good evening to you.
Yeah, I have to say that you are doing well and that you have won the appreciation of many. And that on the side of what you have taken the side of Calvary's resurrection. And many of us stand with you.
I'm grateful. We're doing the Lord's work and the work we're paid to do.
Okay, but tonight we'll ask you all the questions.
Very well.
And then we can deal with it. You tell us what's happening with the processes in Parliament. People must understand that as well. Definitely. Where is the bill? What is it going to do in Parliament? Before then, let's just take a little bit of a time to give you and our viewers the real history of this matter. Kuku is going to join me in the studio. Kuku, come, let's talk about the history. So he has been working on this for the last 2 days, all the research and all of that. So tell us, where is this coming from? This the prohibition of gay sex, if you like. Where is it coming from?
So the first known statutory prohibition of these activities was by King Henry VIII, way back in the 1500s.
Henry VIII of England?
Yes, Henry VIII of England.
He was against it?
Yes.
Okay.
And he used it, by passing it, certain Catholic monks were incarcerated and their lands were seized and vested in the crown. But the modern...
For them participating in gay sex?
Yes, at the
their
time.
Their lands were seized? Which year is
invested.
This?
That's the 1500s, around 1550, thereabouts.
Okay.
But the modern, the popular modern connotation of it, or its criminalization, was in the English Parliament in 1885, through the Labouchere Amendments to the Criminal and Other Offences Act of 1885. Mm-hmm. And the purpose of this amendment was to criminalize same-sex relations between two consenting male adults. That was what was actually used and enforced till the Wolfenden Report on Homosexual Offences in 1957 recommended that it ought to be no longer necessary. However, from then, it was then exported to common law jurisdictions of the world. Particularly, common law jurisdictions are nations that were colonized by England. Mm-hmm. But that was a statutory restriction. It does not necessarily mean that African customs or African traditional settings did not frown on it.
Okay, I know that, but I want us to see whether there is actually a linkage between our colonial relations and this prohibition. Because if you look at the picture today, you will see the African on one side and the white man on one side, the European on one side. But what you are telling us is interesting, that the European and the African used to be on the same side on this matter. And that, in fact, they actually codified it under King James. So, but the Bond of 1844 will predate your 1960, isn't it? And the Bond of 1844 had some prohibitions of ritual murder, pioneering, and all of that. Yes. But that didn't say, the Bond didn't say, yeah, thank you for putting that up there. Okay. The Bond didn't say, they didn't prohibit gay.
Yeah, that's true, because in the year 1844, at that time, the British did not have full political jurisdiction over the Gold Coast. Mm-hmm. That occurred in 1874, and that was when they exerted their influence to be a political power, or formerly known what we often call a colonial power, over the Gold Coast. Mm-hmm. And so it was from there that they could then extend. However, there is evidence of it being restricted among British settlers in the Gold Coast as far back as 1860. And the reason was that at the time, a lot of British citizens would leave the UK, settle in certain colonies, particularly around the fort, so somewhere around Christiansburg, and would be engaging in certain activities that the Crown thought was not right. Therefore, it was imperative that these laws were exported to compel them to do what the Crown thought was right, even when they were in the colonies, in Gold Coast and other areas.
What you're saying is that there was suspicion that this practice, which at the time in the eyes of the British was a prohibited practice, will be carried out when they get outside the shores of Britain, when they come to the colonial places. So the law was exported to be able to catch them, even when they do that in Sierra Leone, in Ghana, in Nigeria, India, in Burma, and all of that.
Exactly.
That's interesting. That's very far-reaching.
That is why many common law countries, that's countries formerly colonized by UK, used a similar wording. Either they used Bagri, or they use unnatural carnal knowledge. Mm-hmm. So the roots is similar. The roots of statutory restriction is similar. But then we decided again in 1960 to then adopt our own sort of our own criminal offense, Criminal Offenses Act. It used to be the Criminal Code, but it was changed in 2005 to be the Criminal and Other Offenses Act through the review of VCRAC CRAB. Mm-hmm. And in section 104 of this act, these actions are prohibited. It is interesting to note, however, that section 104 restricts or prevents or prohibits sexual relations even between a man and a woman in an unnatural manner. So it is sexual relations in an unnatural manner or sexual relations with an animal. Therefore, if there is no penetration to the vagina, it is restricted by law, by the
criminal. Even if it's a man and a woman.
Even if it's a man and a woman.
Let me ask some judge, is that correct? That unnatural sex, even with a woman, is prohibited by Act 29, Criminal Offences Act?
Well, if you look at the Republic versus Badusin, where the Supreme Court tried to distinguish what is natural canal knowledge, mm-hmm. they seem to suggest that when it is not penetrative, it is deemed, when it is not penetrating the vagina, it is deemed to be canal natural knowledge.
Yes. So that's also prohibited. Yes. Does that find expression in the bill that you are supporting?
Yes. So right now what we're trying to do is to have reflections that cover lesbianism and all other manifestations, which the limited definition of unnatural canal knowledge in Section 104 of Act 29 seem to have a challenge with. But if I could quickly add, giving the perspective he's bringing, you should bear in mind that the law has its spirit in its letter. What was the spirit in 1960, 61 years ago?
1960, okay.
Yes, the Criminal Offences Act. Mm-hmm. At that time, what did we know as homosexuality? It was largely gayism. Mm-hmm. And that's how come, springing from the bond of 1844, you realize that it is largely focused on gayism. Because mm-hmm. at that time, things like pansexualism, transgenders, queers were an unknown entity at the time. And so these are latter day additions. And you realize that even today, as we speak, there are new variations of homosexuality that are still being discovered. Mm. You get it? So we may end up with all
the... You answered the question I was going to ask you before we take our break. I was going to ask you, why is this law inadequate? And many people have asked you that on social
Definitely.
Media. I think you answered that in part. We'll get to that in some detail. So you heard what he was talking about. Let's talk about this pariah state. This is another question I'll be asking him. Yeah. That if we do that, and you have seen that Madina MP Sosu has talked about that.
Yes.
And Gabi Oshiridako has talked about that. That if we proceed with this, we could become a pariah state. Tell us about what international law says about these things.
Now, that is the dicey area. The international law, the Human Rights Committee of the United Nations, in the case of Tunin versus Australia, noted that the manifestation of sexuality is a human right. But the problem with that is that decisions of committees, of human rights commissions, of convention against torture, international courts and things of the sort, are not binding sources of international law. So in order for you to ascertain, or in order for you to say that indeed this is fundamentally a human right, because if you look at the first generation of rights, civil and political rights, social, economic rights, these are rights that have generally been accepted indeed as
the right of association. I mean, the bill is banning the advocacy, rights of association. Could that be problematic?
Honestly, I feel that is quite problematic, because association does not necessarily, or association or advocacy may not necessarily mean engaging in the act. For instance, if we have people that advocate for using of marijuana, it doesn't necessarily mean that they use marijuana.
But if marijuana is illegal, mm-hmm. how do you then permit the advocacy of it?
Well, Ghanaians having free speech was illegal at a point, and we advocated to be independent. Same in South Africa and many places.
Free speech is fundamental. It's mm-hmm. a first generation right.
Yeah.
Is homosexuality first generation right?
That's the problem. That's where we go back to Tunin versus Australia and how it is not really widespread. But if you even look at the nature, if you look at Article 2, Clause 7 of the UN Charter, it provides that internal matters of states are not subject to interference by the United Nations, and it is left for us to determine what and what we decide to accept. If you also look at Article 27, Clause 2 of the African Charter on Human and People's Rights, it's provided that the manifestation of rights of individuals is subject to the collective good and to public morality, even though there is an interpretation on that. Mm-hmm. In 2017, the African Court on Human Rights interpreted that provision in the decision of the African Commission for Human and People's Rights versus Kenya on paragraph 188 of the report that in order to fall within this provision, two elements must be present. The first is that the enjoyment of that right must adversely affect the entire society. Mm-hmm. And two, that the restriction must be commensurate with the threats that the enjoyment of that harm provides. Therefore, if we say that our restriction has to be in tandem with international law, then we have to show that the enjoyment of or the manifestation of homosexuality and other related matters adversely affects the larger society.
I like the way he used enjoyment.